This program features live coverage of an African safari and may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
Welcome to the African bush, and it's very exciting to have you here. We've got not one but two leopards. Very exciting to have two leopards in the same place. It's a brother and a sister. Now, a big welcome to our schools who are with us today. This is your very own private safari. I really look forward to having all your questions. We do apologize about the delay. We are live in the middle of the African bush, so sometimes we do have a few technical difficulties, but fortunately our tech team were able to sort it out. But there we go. And for those of you who've been watching for a while, it is indeed Hosana and Shongile together. So they are together. Karula, I'm sure, if was around with them, she might have left them. She could be lying in the shade close by. Now, after we finished the sunrise safari this morning, on our way home, my cameraman Dangerous Dave and myself found a drag mark to a kill, and we went back with Herbie this afternoon and we walked, and unfortunately they finished the kill. It was a tiny baby impala, but they didn't move too far. That is the young male, Hosana. And you can see it's very, very hot out here, probably 95 Fahrenheit. And the leopards have found a nice shady spot to snooze. You can see they've got nice full tummies, breathing heavily. Well, it looks like the young male's eaten more than the young female though. So I know there was a lot of speculation about whether Karula, because she was mating, that Karula's their mother, and she was going to leave the cubs. And as I said, I was quite sure she would go back to the cubs. And from the tracks we found, I found where she killed an impala. Sorry, 1 minute, guys. Standing by, Ephraim. Copy, thanks, F. We've got Karula. Karula's Tumam Pimpans on Jiga Jiga and Lera. So very, very exciting for everyone who's been watching for a while. His head's up. He's very hot, very uncomfortable. He's got a very full belly, so he's trying to breathe as heavily as possible. So what he's doing is he's taking air over his tongue, where there's lots of veins and blood vessels, and while breathing he cools it down and then sends cooler blood through the rest of his body. So I was saying we tracked, well, Herbie actually found them on foot with Taxon's help, but where we tracked it to a tree where they had a meal last night. And it's amazing, three leopards make very short work of a little baby impala. So under the tree, all I could find where they'd been eating was a tuft of hair, and that's all that's left. So that's the top of the brain, or the top of the skull, sorry. So the brain would have sat inside here. So a very, very young impala. And you can see it's fresh. There's still some sinew attached. So that's all that's left of an impala after three, or baby impala after three leopards eat it. Now, a mom could be lying close by. I keep having a quick look under the bushes. Or she could have been out to try find some more food for these hungry little ones. Now, we've just explained, but in case some of you missed it, why the leopards are breathing so heavily, it's to try cool down. So they're taking cool air over their tongue and over the other blood vessels in their mouth that cools the blood, and then they pump it through to the rest of their body. They're unable to sweat like we can. So you can see how hot it is today. You can see that bright blue sky. There is a little bit of cloud around, not too much. Now Hunter is wondering, how many spots does a leopard have? Well, Hunter, why don't you start counting? It depends on individual leopards, and I'm not sure. I've never counted all the spots on a leopard, but I can tell you for sure there's a lot. Very, very warm today. So we're going to sit here, see if the mother leopard comes back. And while we do that, you must remember, I'm not the only one out here. We have another vehicle out there, as well as Taylor, who's walking in the bush. So let's go see where Taylor's walking.
Good afternoon and welcome. Well, this is my aunt out here walking around in the beautiful wilderness of Africa. Now, my name is Taylor McCurdy, and on camera with me this afternoon, VM, as well as Herbert, you may see a little bit later, and he's out protecting us, making sure no animals sneak upon us. Now, isn't it so exciting that you've been able to see some leopards with Brent? I've got something to show you over there, though. So, Brent found some egg marks after this morning's safari, and we followed this afternoon, and we actually found where Karula had caught a baby impala, and she dragged it all the way to where we are right now. BM got caught onto a tree there, it attacked him. Now, Karula, as well as her two cubs, were here. Let me take my multi-tool out, and feeding on this baby impala. And I'm actually going to show you what it looks like, what their jaw looks like. We'll have a look. Look at that. Isn't that incredible? You can see all the little teeth over here, but you can see it was still a very, very small baby. Now, if you think that this is quite sad, don't worry. Remember, Karula's cubs have got to eat too, so they can become big and strong like she is. And that's not all that we have here. We actually can see how she took the baby impala all the way up to the top of the tree. So first you can see all the hair down on the ground. Can you see all that fluff? So they pull the hair out because they don't want to eat that, otherwise they're going to get a nasty fibble. And then, to keep it nice and safe from predators like hyenas and maybe some lions or even the leopards, she would have stood here, she would have done a big jump and climbed her way up. And if you look very carefully in the fork of the tree, you may even see some of the hairs. Look at that. You can see them blowing around in the wind. So she kept it there. Or maybe it is even Shongile or Hosana who were practicing. And now look right over here. Look at that. That is a claw mark. Can you see it? So you can see that little thing over there. That's where the nails came out and gripped onto the tree, and they pulled themselves all the way up to the fork of that tree. Isn't that incredible? So just walking around here, we found the crime scene, and then you got to see the leopards as well. But like I said, we're out walking around. We're going to be looking for lots of small insects and things too. So let's carry on. Let's see what we can find next. Ooh. I did see a little grasshopper. down around here, so we'll have a little look and see if we can up again. I'm going to be very careful. I don't want to squash anything that's moving around here. Oh, there you are. Now I've got to try and catch. This can be quite difficult. Actually, VM, I think I'm going to try and catch it because this one is a very difficult one to actually try and pick up. Let's see if we can have a look at it. So, VM, can you see this piece of grass here? It's just in front of the grass. Can you see it? Just there. I don't want to go too close. Just with my fingers. Look how camouflaged it is. Can you see that? It almost looks... I'm going to put this there. I don't want it to jump. It almost looks like it's the sand. And if this grasshopper were to leap away, you might even be able to see it. There's a little bit of red on the inside of its legs. But it's hidden now. But as soon as it jumps to try and escape its predator, it'll open up that red colouring and it'll give a big bright flash. And that when the grasshopper lands on the sand again, it'll become invisible. And the predator, so maybe it was something like a bird or anything that really eats insects, would try and look for the red colour. It would forget about what the grasshopper looked like initially. And then, because it's hidden away, that gives a grasshopper an opportunity to get away. Isn't that incredible how nature has these amazing ways to try and hide the smallest of creatures? But like Brent said, it's not just the two of us. There's one more person that is dying to say hello to all of you. So let's jump across in Evia's vehicle and see what his plans are for the rest of the day.
They say Chololo somewhere. I'm going to try. Sure. Good afternoon, folks. How are we doing this afternoon? I'm FW, and with me I've got Brian Joubert and the Thumb. Brian, who is the Thumb this afternoon?
The Thumb is Mistletoe.
Awesome, great. Into the spirit of Christmas we go. So, welcome also to all the kids from Virginia Beach in the USA. We are on the prowl looking for a pride of lions. There was a call earlier on the radio and apparently we are not that far. So we want to try and see if we can get them, catch up to them again, see what they're up to. Lovely afternoon out in the bush, nice and hot. Most likely these lions will just be sleeping if we do find them, doing what they do best. They love sleeping. I think in my next life I'd love to be a lion, and I've just spotted one just to the left of us. There's a lioness, and there's some cubs just further to the left. Brian, let me go forward a bit more. In the shade, fast asleep. How amazing is that? Look at that, rolling around, getting comfy. So, as far as I understand, this is the Nkahuma Pride of Lions. So this group has got 5 adult lionesses and 6 cubs. It's such a special sighting. Do you see how heavy it's breathing? They've had a meal on the way to finding them now. We drove past a kill that they had maybe a day or so ago. and they're still digesting that, and the heavy breathing is helping with the digestion. It's called panting. What do you kids think? Would it be a nice... We are going to head over to Brent. He has got another spotted cat to show you.
So we're still with the same two spotted cats. And because it is so hot at the moment, they're doing exactly what they're supposed to do in this heat, which is have a snooze. Oh, he must have been bitten by a biting fly. And you can see how his coat sort of shimmers a little bit. It almost has, almost looks like he gets a cold shiver. And that's actually the nervous system that's designed to keep biting insects off them. And you'll notice one of the only things that'll be moving a lot at the moment is their heads or their ears, and it's again to keep away the stable flies. So stable flies are a small species of biting fly that eat blood, the same species of fly that will attack domestic dogs, horses. Obviously that's where they get their name from, stable fly, because they're often found around stables. So these are not cheetahs, DJ, these are leopards, and leopards live throughout Africa, apart from in the driest desert. They also occur throughout the Middle East, India, Asia, all the way to Russia. So they've got a very widespread distribution. Cheetahs are quite different. They have spots, not rosettes. So if we look at a leopard's spots, they're not truly spots, they're little circles of spots that are called rosettes. Now leopards are much more differently built to a cheetah. They're shorter, stockier, and much stronger than a cheetah. A cheetah is taller, but also a cheetah is a crepuscular hunter, which means that they're most active at dusk and dawn. They have black under their eyes to try diffuse daylight, whereas a leopard has white under its eyes to try absorb as much ambient light at the night as possible. Now Ken is wondering, how do we tell one leopard from the other? Well, they have unique spots, Ken. Oh dear, I don't know. Let me see, I'm gonna try to get you a picture of their spot pattern. Oopsie. Now, it's quite difficult to see from this angle. Let's try to go back a little bit on the female. See if I can see her. Oh no, wait, oh, he sat up. That'll be better. Okay. Oh, that's a bit dark. I'm just trying to get a good view of his spots for you. There we go. So now, how do we tell different leopards apart? So above their last line of whiskers, they all have a unique spot pattern. So there we go. See, there's the last line of whiskers. And there is the spot pattern. So you see, he's got 1, 2, 3, and on the other side, he's got One, two, three. So each leopard will have a different spot pattern above their last line of whiskers, and that's the best way to identify the different individuals. So we're with the second biggest big cat in Africa, but let's go back to Efvir, who's with the biggest.
So while you were with Brent, we have repositioned our vehicle a little bit and have got a beautiful view. We have got a beautiful view of these cubs. How nice is that? Let's watch this guy move around us. And he disappears. Back to these two. Hunter, you are asking how fast is a lion? Lions run at around 22 meters per second when they are running at full speed, which converts to about 80 kilometers an hour. With miles an hour, I'm not sure. I would say maybe 50, if I'm not mistaken. Somewhere around 50 miles an hour. I'll just wait for this last one to maybe get up and move to the rest of the pride. The others are all behind me. I think we'll get a nice surprise when this guy, little guy, wants to move. See how he's cleaning himself? Their tongues are quite rough. It's like almost like sandpaper. And that allows them to clean themselves very well. And when they're feeding on a carcass, it allows them to take a lot of the meat off the bones in places that's difficult to chew on and not be able to get their teeth around it or into an area. Brian, maybe we can swing the camera around. It looks like all these cubs. Thuraya, you're asking about panting and how it helps with digestion. Before I answer this question, let me just tell you what these lions are up to. They are busy suckling. They're busy having a bit of milk from mum. How nice is that? The panting would help with digestion. I think it just gives a bit of extra oxygen going through the body and all the processes just work better. How special is this to see all the cubs drinking? As the cubs get older and they start drinking less milk and eating more meat, they'll still keep trying to get a bit of milk from mum every now and then. And at some stage she gets quite angry with them and they start hurting her. And that really causes a bit of discomfort for her. You can imagine those sharp teeth biting into her. White Oaks Elementary, you are asking why some lions have hair around their neck. That hair around the neck is actually called a mane, and it is male lions that carry the mane. So it's to show which is male, which is female, and also it acts as a protection layer for when the males are fighting and trying to protect their prides and the territory that they do have. Mostly you'd only see them on males, but there has been record of females also having them. That's maybe just a quick or a genetic mutation that comes through, but it's not seen too often. I don't know of any record of that in the Kruger National Park area of the area that we are in. I know there's been record of that in Botswana. FC, could you just repeat that question? I didn't... Yeah, there's a lot of other chatter on the radio. I didn't hear you. Sorry, there's something not working with my mic. With my earpiece, I'm struggling to pick up what you guys are saying. Folks, while I try and sort out my earpiece problem, we're going to stay with these lions for a bit. We're going to go and see what Taylor is up to on the bushwalk.
This is incredible what I can see from over here, and I'm sure you probably want to have a look at what I'm looking at. So, and I've said this before, we are looking at the hardest working creatures out in the world. It is termites, but we are specifically looking at termites that are called harvester termites. And it's very easy to know why they're called harvester termites, because you can see they're out and they've been collecting pieces of grass, bits of leaves, and all sorts of other goodies for most of the day. And look how they've made these little storage pits. Can you see that? There's one there. There's another storage pit over there. And well, this is actually an Inyala footprint that we're looking at. Oh, look at this one. That's not a termite. That is a velvet ant. Be careful, VM. It's coming for you. Now that massive creature that you can see there, that is actually a wasp. But it's a female wasp, a girl wasp. And she doesn't have any wings, so she can't fly, but the males can fly. But she's got a nasty sting on her, so you gotta be careful, you don't wanna pick one of those up. But this is something that I haven't really seen too much of, and I've really only read about it, is that these harvester termites have these storage pits, and you can see they're dropping it there, they're carrying on, going to work. And then there are others that are going from the entrance. You can see this is where they are living in here. And they are going to fetch it, take it, and then somebody else will come around and take it underneath the ground where they'll make food about it. That's amazing, don't you think? You can see when you just start looking on the ground, and you can see them, they are everywhere. It looks like the ground is alive because the grass is moving. But of course, the grass is not moving. It's moving because of all those wonderful termites. And lots of different animals will eat the termites. Birds, monkeys, snakes, frogs, owls, anything you can think of. Even a hyena will lap up some of these termites. And even us, if you were out here and you were stuck in the wild and you didn't have anything to eat, the termites are delicious. Now, I've seen some antelope in the distance. Let's see if we can have a view. So now you've got to get out your binoculars, and if you look far into the distance, you can actually see some impala. Now they don't know that we are here at the moment. And that's because we have got the wind in our favor, so we're standing downwind of those impala, so they can't see us. And I don't think they can hear us because the wind is quite strong, so it is muffling the sound. But also, if we're were to turn and look towards us, they'd be looking straight into the sun. And if they're looking into the sun, you know you shouldn't look into the sun with your naked eyes, otherwise you're going to damage them. And it's the same thing with the animals. They look towards the sky, and then they can't see. Can't see what I'm doing. So we are very lucky. We've got everything in our favor. So let's see if we can go up and get a little bit closer. Now, the idea of being out on a walk is that you don't want to be spotted. Now, Hunter, hello, hope you're well. You were wondering if termites eat meat. No, they predominantly feed on things like leaves and grasses, those types of things. They don't really eat any meat. And some of the termites, like the large fungus-growing termite, which makes massive big mounds, they actually grow their own food. They grow mushrooms, and they eat those. Isn't that incredible? Seems as though, let's see where these impala have gone. Now, Jordan, you were wondering if termites are like ants. Even though they look a little bit similar, they're actually completely different. They are in two different families, and they're not really related to each other at all. Now, ants seem to be more diurnal. Now, diurnal, it's quite a big word, right? That means that they are active. They come out and they work during the day. Whereas most of the termites, except the harvester termites that we just saw, are nocturnal. Now, nocturnal means the complete opposite. So that means that they come out when the sun goes to sleep and it is nighttime. So those are some of the differences. And then, of course, if you look at their bodies, they look a little bit different. Now, we're using this bush, the shrub, as cover. And we're going to see if we can have a look. But now, Viam, have you heard that? You can hear that. Trrr, trrr. That is the sound of a bird called an oxpecker. Now, oxpeckers normally sit on the animal's backs, from an elephant to a rhinoceros to a buffalo to an impala. And they will eat all the ticks and fleas that are sitting on their backs. Now, luckily for us though, they're not on any animals. They're sitting up in a tree. But because we are walking around, it is very, very important that you make sure that you listen out to what's happening around you. And if you hear something like an oxpecker, it's always very good to stop, listen, try and see where they are, because it could mean that maybe there's a buffalo sleeping behind a bush and you couldn't see him. But those birds will alarm you, or give us an opportunity to be able to see that animal and not get in that animal's way, really. Now, we're coming up to a nice pan now, quite a big pan. And hopefully what we'll do is we're probably going to try and look for some footprints. Right, so we've still got a little bit of a way to go, but we're going to get there soon, and hopefully we're going to show you some amazing animal footprints. But first, let's go back across to those beautiful sleepy lions.
All right, I've sorted out my earpiece, and Kelsey, I heard your question. You are asking why these cubs aren't as playful as the wolf pups that you are studying at school at the moment. They can be very playful. It is a hot day, so they're just relaxing and sleeping off the heat, waiting for the heat to pass. Later on during this afternoon, as it gets dark and cools down, they'll start playing a lot more. Often you see these babies running around, chasing each other, tripping over each other. All that play that they do have is all for the development for later in life, teaching them styles of hunting and how to take down prey, etc. So they can be very playful. They're just hot at the moment. It's like us after a big meal on a Sunday afternoon. You want to go and take a nap. Same thing, yeah. They just do it a lot more and often. J,
Jerry, you are asking what time of the day they hunt. Whenever opportunity presents itself, they will hunt. But their activity time is night time, so that gives them a better opportunity. They see much better at night, and most of their successful hunts would be at night rather than during the day. One of the things that help them, if we can zoom into one of their eyes, one of these adults, maybe we can look at, you'll see on the around the eye, and especially on the bottom, there's white markings, and that helps to reflect light into the eyes, and that assists at night to help them see better. White Oaks Elementary, you are asking how old lions get before they become adults. Probably around 2.5 to 3 years. That is when male cubs get pushed out of their natal pride and have to start fending for themselves. And as they grow into full maturity, it would take about maybe up to 4 or 5 years to be able to be strong enough to be able to take over a pride like this, push out the old male and take over. Females, about three to four years, they'll be fully grown and ready for mating. Folks, I think we're going to leave these lion cubs and their mums to do their thing. I don't think we're going to get any reaction or movement from them anytime soon. I think we must carry on, see what else we can find. Maybe we bump into some elephants. But for the time being, while we get out of the sighting and start looking for some elephants, we're going to head back over to Brent with the beautiful leopards.
Well, there's not much movement happening here apart from the occasional head flick to try avoid all the biting flies that are abounding at the moment, the stable flies in particular. Is quite a peaceful spot here with the sleeping leopards. Shongile is very, very comfortable at the moment. Hello, White Oaks Elementary. Who would like to know how hot is it? As I said, it's about 90 degrees Fahrenheit here, and apparently it's 35 Fahrenheit where you are. I don't know, but that just sounds terribly cold to me. I'd much rather be sitting at 90 Fahrenheit, so half. So it's about 15, 14 degrees Celsius. No, that's not warm. I'd much rather be hot and sitting next to the leopards. Now, Jade would like to know, do leopards ever get cold? Well, probably not really, Jade. They are quite well insulated with their fur. I'm sure maybe during certain rainstorms and whatnot, they might get a little bit cold, but their bodies are designed to live outside in the elements. So they are probably used to it or good at dealing with it.
full stretch.
He looks like he's just can't find that comfortable spot where his sister has found the comfortable spot. And I think she's barely moved a muscle since we have found them earlier today. Just can't get comfortable. Also looks like he's eaten a bit more, it would make him a bit warmer as well. Hello, Jordan. Jordan would like to know, how do we tell the difference between a male and a female? Well, Jordan, size. Male leopards are much bigger than female leopards, even at this young age, when they're both 10 months old, he's probably a good 30 or 40% bigger than she is. Now, it's a bit difficult to see when they're lying down, but she is at the back there, you can see, and then he's on the right. When they're adults, the males are almost double the size of the females. There she is, fast asleep. You can see that perfect little paw. Now, while the leopards are snoozing and not doing much, let's go see what Taylor's doing next to the waterhole.
So we're sitting here at the little pan where there's a camera that watches what is so watching over us. There's two of us. And VM, did that little plant fly away? We were looking at the tiniest little bird that is responsible for leaving. Oh, now I better hope that I don't sink back. The ground is very soft. Let me go down, have a look. All over here you can see the tiniest little footprints. And those were left by a very small bird called a three-banded plover. And it came through to say hello, but I think it got a fright and flew away. But that's okay, because other friends, but you're going to have to look very, very carefully at the surface of the water, and you should see a little head popping out of the top of the water. Can you see one, Viam? Now those are called terrapins, but if you're from America, you may call them turtles. Now they're very much the same thing. Except here in South Africa, we see tortoises, which are on land, and they have a big shell, and they've got claws, but they do not have web between their toes, so they are not the greatest swimmers. Then you get the terrapin, which lives in these murky waters, or even sometimes salt water too. And they've got webs between their toes. And then you get turtles, which you see in the ocean, which have got massive big flippers. They don't have any claws or any webbing at all. Now, these little terrapins, as you can see them just poking their heads up very quickly to catch their breaths, they'll be eating all the little insects that are coming down to the water to maybe come and get a drink too. And of course, there'll be some insects that are swimming around in the water as well. They don't get very big, and you can see lots and lots of bubbles being blown around by the wind. It's really beautiful here, but sadly no big lion tracks. I was hoping we were going to come here and find a big lion footprint, but we've still got one pan we can go to, so maybe we should head back around and go to the other little pan and see what's happening down there. What do you think? I think you should come with me, but we'll be careful not to fall in the mud over here. Now, Jordan, you were wondering if that pond was deep. Now, it actually isn't that deep. I want to show you something. It's probably about maybe this much water in it, but there's lots and lots of mud. Have a look here. Can you see all these footprints? See how they have sunk into the mud? It's probably an inyala, which is an antelope, walking through here and was getting a little bit stuck in the mud. That would happen if you were to go in that water. You'd probably think it was than what it was. we're going to do now is you're going to see a different view.
Watch.
Wave the end. Wave the end. Wave.
Hello.
Hello, everybody. How cool is this? We have this camera that is looking over the watering holes so that if any elephants or any animals come down to have a drink, even the birds, we get to see them. Right, now, then you're back to my view. Let's go around and start strolling down towards the next pan and see who we've got. Those impala that we saw earlier, they ran away because unfortunately I was making a little bit too much noise, but that's okay, they'll come back. There's plenty of water around at the moment. We're gonna go and check the next pan to see if there are any more footprints, and I'm gonna send you back across to have a look at those lions once more.
So we've left the lions sleeping and we got lucky and found a young elephant male, a young bull elephant on his own. He looks like he's at that age where he's been pushed out of the herd by all the females and kind of have to start fending for himself, maybe join up with a group of males, bigger males, to teach him and show him the way of elephant life. I would say this guy is maybe 12, 13 years old at the moment. So right at that teenager age, we're almost ready for high school. As far as I know, we haven't seen elephant for a while, so this is quite exciting to get a bit of elephant interaction and have a bit of a view on the biggest animal out here. It's brilliant. Let's keep following it. I'm gonna try and find a route through the bush here and get back onto the road and stay with him. So just hang on while we do that. Hunter, you are asking if elephants have fur. They don't have a lot of hair, no. When they're born, there's a tiny bit of hair covering the baby, and as they grow older, after a couple of months, they lose that hair. So they don't have that protection against the sun like some of the other animals, and a way for them to stay cool is they cake themselves with mud. They throw themselves, they use their trunk, pick it up, throw it over the body and cools down like that. And when we get closer to him, you'll see he's fanning his ears the whole time as well. That also helps to cool them down, as the blood, there's a huge amount of blood vessels in the ear. He's just in front of us to the left. Jaylin, you are asking, how far can we hear an elephant? It depends on what they're doing. If they're trumpeting, you can hear them at quite a distance. I've got a very loud trumpet. If they are just moving through the bush, you don't really hear them. They walk through the bush very, very, very silently. And with that, you might hear a branch breaking here and there when they're feeding, but if they're not trumpeting, then we struggle hearing them. It is crazy that an animal that gets so big can be so quiet. Let's just keep going, keep a view of this guy. To all the kids that joined us this afternoon, I hope you've had a brilliant time. Goodbye, enjoy the rest of your day. I hope this was a good start to your day. We're gonna head over to Brent and he's gonna show you and carry on with that nice leopard. So there's been no movement here with young Shongile and Hesana. They still have not moved a muscle. Sleeping in the shade. We're not 100% sure where Karula is. She was here earlier, that's for sure, from the tracks that we found. She might have headed off to go try keep these hungry little rugrats fed. The flies still bothering poor Hesana. Now, Larry is wondering, wouldn't it be cooler up in a tree? It depends, Larry. And sometimes you will find leopards will go up into a tree because it is a bit cooler. Obviously, they're not feeling it's that hot today. Must remember, this part of South Africa gets much, much hotter than what we're experiencing at the moment. So probably feel no need to go tree climbing just yet. Not that uncomfortable. A lot of it's also got to do with his belly, and sometimes when they do have big bellies, a tree is definitely not the most comfortable spot. Now, Valeria is saying she can't believe the size difference between brother and sister. It's huge, and that it is, and it is really noticeable, even from a very young age, in both leopard and lion, how much physically bigger the males are than the females. We can hear the woodland kingfisher in the background. We can hear a Cape turtle dove calling. Or common sounds of the African bushveld. Now, while we sit here in the sun, soaking up the afternoon rays, it seems like Taylor's having a beach day and visiting yet another waterhole. Let's go have a look.
We do have a woodland kingfisher sitting in the top of a tree. And now we know the woodland kingfisher, they like to eat insects. However, that's not going to stop them from fishing if there is the opportunity. And we had one now just dive bomb into the water. I had such a fright. I didn't know what it was. It was just this big splash next to me. And then we saw it obviously hop out of the water and off it go. It could have also just been coming down maybe to have a quick drink or a quick dive in the water. But there's lots and lots of insects also sitting on the top of the water. But it's amazing how the animals will utilize different things depending well on weather and all sorts of other goodies. But once again, unfortunately, there isn't any big cat tracks here. I was hoping to find a nice lion track that was perhaps, or a leopard track that was perhaps preserved in the mud. But we're going to go back around the corner because we did find another interesting track, and it was from a tortoise. We can actually see where it came and drank. So I'd love to show you those, but we'll just go back around this way and see if we can find them again. They were so tiny. It was an interesting thing to pick up on. Let's see. Right. Let's go back around. There were some really, really nice ones here. Here we go. I'm going to go down. I know there's no crocodiles here because I've been watching for ages and ages, and well, nothing has come up. And I'm sure we probably would have seen them on the dam cam. But look at this. You see that there? The little claw marks from a tortoise that had obviously, like Herbert said, had to put its 4x4 on and come down this bank. And it had a drink over here. We know that the tortoises love to drink lots and lots of water, especially while it's available. And well, then it carried on walking along all the way, and it stopped at the elephant footprint where there's a bit of dung, and had another drink over here. And you see where it came along, walked down, you can see its claws, had a drink, around, and off it went. Now, I said to Herbert, wouldn't it be amazing if we could actually find that tortoise? But I suspect that it's probably from maybe yesterday, maybe later in the afternoon. I don't think it was from today. But isn't that amazing? Let's see what else we've got here. This little crater that we're in is quite beautiful, and there's so much life that's growing in here. Maybe we find some interesting little flowers and things that are unique to growing close to water. But we'll have a little squiz. The ground is so hard as well. Oh, maybe we get something interesting over here. This is like another pan of water that's drying out a lot quicker than the others. Oh, this is quite interesting. Come have a look, Avium. Can you see these little marks on the ground? This looks like a bird of some sort was coming through and probing the ground. Especially if you look over here, you can see that little circle. See how it goes straight down into the ground? Maybe a little three-banded plover, maybe even the blacksmith lapwings. And then you can see a clear trail coming out over here and going around. That looks like it was from a little terrapin that was moving around. Every now and then you can just see a couple of claws. And almost that, there we go, you can see the little claws there. And I remember, I'll never ever forget that when I first started guiding and I did my very first tracking assessment, we came to an area where there was just mud. And the assessor said to us, circled the section and said, what is this? And basically what it was, is it just flat surface of mud with lots and lots of little holes anywhere. I did not get that question right. I couldn't guess for the life of me of what it was. And then only when we came back and she said, no, you got that wrong. And I said, okay, well, what is it? And she told me that it was a bird probing. I was just like, that is incredible. You would never think something that's so obvious, but yet that's exactly what it was. But we'll find a nice checkerboard of probes. Now, Viola Orhart, you were wondering if it's stinky at the watering hole. Over there, there's that kingfisher again. It just dives straight down into the water. You can actually just see the ripples from where it landed. You see that? That's incredible. If we can catch it, it might be difficult though. Now, Viola, you were wondering if it's stinky at the water. That's not so bad because there's quite a bit of water, and the same thing up with the dam cam is, but I suspect in the next, maybe the next week or two, it's probably going to smell. But over here, where the water is obviously extremely stagnant, it's being absorbed into ground, you now get that horrible musky sort of drain water smell, which is not very pleasant, but it's not too bad yet. I've definitely seen worse. Especially when you've had a buffalo or some animal sitting and wallowing in it for most of the day. And it's a really terrible smell. That one we'll try and avoid those. Since we all know I don't have the strongest stomach in the team. That is not my talent. So we'll carry on. Herbert, where did Herbert go? He's away from us. Herbert is out scouring. Now, when you come into a section like this and you are on a walk, obviously we know, we say we can see what's going on around us. Now, the tricky part is that you don't know what's going on the other side of these embankments. So it's very important that you take very slow, very easily, and make as little noise as possible. We're lucky though. We do have the wind in our favor, so that should help us. It should help us, of course, as we go over this wall. It'll give us a bit of cover in case there was maybe some buffalo or elephants on the other side that wouldn't pick up on us as quickly. Now, Tammy, you're wondering if it is scary out here. Of course, you've got to be a little bit nervous. If you aren't nervous, well, I would say I think there's something wrong with you out here, because there's lots of different animals. But I'm not scared because I'm afraid of the animals. The animals are more afraid of me It's just important that you don't surprise anything and you give them a chance. But, well, at the moment there are lots of different things, like snakes and wasps and lizards and all types of things. So it's also very important in the summer months to watch on the ground where you're walking. You wouldn't want to stand on a snake's tail, because if you were to stand on a dog's tail, it would probably bite you. A snake will do exactly the same thing. So what we're going to do now is we're going to send you back across to Evia, because we need to sneak over this little crest and make sure we make it out here safely.
Welcome back. We are still exploring Arethusa. We at a place called Red Dam. Let's see if there's any water here. Doesn't look like it from the way we're coming in here. Oh, a tiny bit of water. Awesome. Let's see if there's any creatures around. There's some terrapins jumping back into the water. Got a fright with us coming out. Coming past. They were busy sunning themselves. Our plan for later on is to head back to where the lions are sleeping. So just as the sun starts setting, we'll head back into that area. For the moment, let's keep going and see what else we can find in this area we're in now. It was quite nice seeing the Nkomo Pride. It was the first time I've actually had the privilege of spending time with them, and it's nice to see that they're looking quite healthy, looking like they're getting healthier. Lolo, Khana, Lakaman, Evia, hi there. Just introducing myself to some of the people out here. Elaine, you are asking why some people are calling me FVA and not FW. From a language perspective, if I say FVA to English-speaking people, I've had some very funny names, and I've been called Evian, like the bottle of water. So FW is just generally easier for people to understand and pronounce. With my name coming from a Dutch-German origin. So I'm Friedrich Willem, and yeah, just got the initials as the name there. This is a beautiful area. We're in a lovely drainage line. To hold on, let me just get on the gas a bit. Through the loose sand we go. There are some tracks on the road here. It looks like the lions might have been here at some stage. Maybe went past the dam we've just driven past, came for a drink, and then carried on to where they were found this afternoon. Maybe it's a different lion, maybe it's a male. With the sand being so loose, I couldn't see properly what exactly it was, a male or a female, but it looked like it was only one lion that moved through this area. BA, you are asking why the... Folks, we're going to head over to Brent for an update. See what he's got for you.
Well, we are playing the patience game at the moment. Now, the sun is dropping quite quickly.
And I think it's one of those, always those difficult situations when you're a safari guide. It's a bit easier when there's a couple of you out, like we are. And, Shungile lifted her head for a split second, then popped it straight back down. So, quite often, patience is your best weapon when it comes to seeing really incredible stuff out in the African bush. Because these cats are flat right now, doesn't mean they're going to be flat forever. It doesn't mean an unsuspecting Franklin or squirrel or dwarf mongoose might wander up. And the only way to see these animals in full flight and action, apart from incredible luck, is good old patience. And so far in my career in the African bush, the patience game has worked very well in my favor. Now, most people who know me well find that quite strange. Brent, patient? That must be absolute nonsense. He's the most impatient person we know. And I will say, yes, that is true. I am very impatient. Unless it comes to following big cats, wild dogs, elephants, or any of the African mammal species that we get out here. And strangely enough, there's one other facet of my life I can show incredible patience in, and that's fishing. Other than that, I'm generally quite an impatient person. But, I mean, let's be honest. We're sitting, she gave herself a hug, sitting about 7 feet away from two of the most exquisite little cats in the Sabi Sands Game Reserve. We are all by ourselves now, so don't even have to share. Now, Ellen is wondering where exactly we are. We're due south of Inga's house, pretty much. Near, in the drainage line that runs from Philemon's Dip around some mud wallows. I hope that helps for you, Ellen. Wait, you've got some spider webs. Thank you. There we go. James is wondering how far Hosanna and Shungile are from where... Well, I didn't see Shungile yesterday, I only saw Hosanna, but I heard where she was. As the crow flies, probably just under 2 kilometers, James. I think Karula killed that baby impala actually right next to Inga's house. And then she's gone back, fetched them. They've actually finished eating that impala probably this morning while we were sitting on cheetah plants. Although I can't really complain about this morning. I got to see Nkanyeni and 2 male cheetah and Vutomi, Nkanyeni's son, who's a little bit older than these chaps. And now, not even 800 meters away from home, I'm sitting with 2 more leopards. How many leopards have we seen today, Dave? We've seen 4 leopards, 2 cheetah, and it's not even Saturday Cat Day. It's Monday. What's Monday? Monday. No, I can't believe it. I'm horrified. I am literally horrified. A piece of my soul was just destroyed by Final Control. They have decided it's Monday Meow Day. No, I refuse. No Monday Meow Day. No. We're going to have to think of something quickly, Dave, before that catches on. Quickly, Dave, think. Monday Mayhem. Monday Magnificence. Pretty much anything except Monday Meow Day is acceptable, I think. Now Final Control is going Meow Day in my ear. Maybe it's because they've been locked up in there for so long, Dave. Maybe we should let them out. Nah. No, actually, Dave, should we let Final Control control out of Final Control? Meow. I'm very funny. So, as I said, the patience game is what we're playing. It's quite likely, as it gets a bit cooler, that the Cubs might start playing. They might go for a drink. You never know when Karula's going to come back. And... of course, it's always that conundrum. Do we go look for other creatures or do we sit
with the cats. My vote is to sit with the cats. But I'd love to hear what you guys think. So I'm voting sit with the cats. Let's see what you guys vote. Should we sit with the cats or should we move? Hashtag Safari Live on Twitter or questions at wildearth.tv. Now, see, this is one of the things why you ponder whether to move or not, because Taylor has found one of my favorite creatures outside of the big cats and wild dogs and elephants. Let's go have a look at what little gem she has found.
For frogs and for some... Can you hear me? Sorry about that. So I've been searching far and wide to have a look at some frogs. And finally, today is the day, and it looks like we have found a foam nest frog. But this is, of course, all thanks to Mr. Herbert, who saved the day once again. And he spotted it as we were actually looking for a dove's nest. Now, this is a lovely spot to be if you are a frog. Well, even a leopard up in a tree would be nice and cool today. Especially with that breeze wafting through the leaves, and of course it's nice and shady. And these tree frogs, unlike other frogs, they don't really need to stay in the water all day long. As long as they stay in a bit of shade and keep themselves nice and cool, they will stay nice and warm, not warm, they will stay nice and moist and be all right. Let's have a look here. There's a couple of eggshells on the ground. Can you see here? Let me pick this one up. Now, this is probably the eggshell from the dove's nest that we're standing below. But unfortunately, I can't see anything in the nest at all. I'm trying to have a look. There were no adults around. I don't see any more eggs because, well, we've got one here. And I can't even see the chicks either. So possibly these chicks have already hatched and been fledged. I'm not sure when this nest was originally found. Oh, here's another shell. Look at that. And it doesn't look like they've been eaten. It actually does look like they have hatched out of them. You can see they're almost quite perfectly intact. This one I broke a little bit as I picked it up off of the ground. I reckon if it was something like maybe a rock monitor that had gotten in here or another bird, they probably would have broken the shell up a little bit more. But this looks perfect for the size of a little chick to push on out of it. So we pop them back on the ground. It seems as though the chicks are no longer, and well, I hope that they did make it out alive and will live to be adults one day. That would be quite exciting. We haven't really seen too much luck with the bird's nest. The one, of course, that we're following at the moment is the hardy-dar nest. That seems to be the favorite nest of everybody, and I don't blame you. They're so cute. So hopefully tomorrow morning we'll go over and have a look and check and see how they're doing. Remember, the last time we were with them, we saw that white stripe on their cheek, and I said that it means that they're between 25 and 27 days old, so a lot older than what we initially thought. So they should be ready to start leaving the nest and forage with their parents. And it would have been amazing if we could have seen that with these doves. Now, Sally, you were wondering this afternoon if there are many snakes out here, and you were saying that we haven't really seen too many out on the bushwalk. I think Steph has had some luck. He's had a couple of snakes. I think James had a stiletto snake, and I think Steph did have a sitting cobra at one point. There's quite a few different types of snakes, but I promise you, the chances of you seeing a snake out here, even if you're walking around, or even if you come on a safari, are really, really slim. They're more scared of us, like the rest of the animals, than what we are of them. So they feel through vibration. So as I'm stomping my size 7 shoe around, or size 6, it depends what make it is, around in the bush, they feel those vibrations. And if they are perhaps sitting out on the road, suntanning, keeping nice and warm, they'll scurry off before we even know that they're there. Thing that they'll leave behind is probably a track in a road, and maybe you'll hear the rustling of the leaves as they disappear. So hopefully, no, after all the rain we've had, maybe we get lucky enough to see a rock python. We should start to see them at night time coming to get the last warmth off of the road. That'll be quite nice to see. And like I said, I haven't seen one in about a year now, so I'm well overdue. Now, Now, Johnny from West Virginia, you were wondering if frogs sleep. Now, I've never come across a sleeping frog before, but what they will do is they sort of estivate, so they'll keep themselves cool, they'll bury themselves in moist sand or mud, that type of thing, for the winter and the cooler periods. That's why you don't really see lots of frogs in the winter months. It's really just, sorry, I heard something breaking, but we're standing near a lodge, and it was obviously somebody opening a door, but I got a fright, thought maybe it was an elephant, but luckily it's not. And so I don't think that they sleep like we as humans do. Remember, these animals are not using a lot of energy throughout the day. It's like how we see the lions resting, and of course the impala and giraffe, and even the other mammals, they only have short rest periods. So I can't imagine... Well, I can't imagine a frog having a two-hour siesta. So maybe when they're just sitting there, like we saw that frog up in the tree, doing much, relaxing, just keeping nice and cool, that's probably a good enough rest for a frog. But I think it would be really entertaining to come around the corner and we'll find seven beds and little frogs sleeping in their beds with their leaf blankets or whatever it may be. But enough of that silly story. We're going to start making our way around back towards the big open plains now and see what's well waiting there for us. But let's go back across to Evier again and we'll see what his plans are now just before the sun goes down.
As the sun is getting closer and closer to the majestic Drakensberg Mountains, we are slowly making our way back to the lions to see if there's going to be any activity. While you've been away, we haven't been seeing much game. It's been fairly quiet, just a bit of bird calls and stuff like that, but nothing much on the animal side. We aren't far from those lions. Actually, we're right here, a lot closer than I thought. All right, well, let's get in here and see what they're up to. Ooh. Folks, I think we might just carry on for the moment. There is a couple of vehicles here. We'll come back in a couple of minutes and come have a look what they're up to. Let me just quickly talk to the guys on the radio. They're stationed in charge of the Ngala Lock. We don't want to put too many vehicles around the lions. The station in charge of the Nkuruma is coming. Apologies for bumping your lock. Could I take your first ammo there, please? So yeah, just try and minimize the amount of pressure on the line, so we just keep it to three vehicles. So as soon as someone moves out, we'll go in and go and have a look again. You are asking why animals are named differently, they're collective nouns. In my opinion, I would say it would have just been very difficult to know what everyone was talking about if all the animals had, for example, a herd as their collective noun. So it makes it a bit easier for everyone to understand what they're talking about, just maybe a quick differentiation between birds and mammals and stuff like that. That would be my first idea why that would have been. Other than that, I don't really know the specific details on that question. I'll have to look it up and find out for you. I'll get back to you on the morning safari. Let's see, while we wait for a chance to go and view those lions, let's see if we can find a nice spot for a sunset. think that elephant we saw a bit earlier was walking on this road maybe earlier this afternoon, and it's moved further north, heading out of our area of operation. It might come into the Juma area through the night, and maybe tomorrow morning we'll get some elephant again. Let's keep our fingers crossed. While I keep looking for a nice spot for the sunset, we're going to head over to Brent, who's still with the leopards.
Well, see, we've got a sunset. But even better, we've got a sunset and two leopards. So they still have not moved very much. Asana did a little bit of a rollover. I think it was the biting flies yet again. Shongile seems to be sleeping as peacefully as any leopard can sleep. I mean, she's barely moved in nearly an hour. Whereas Asana is being a little bit more restless, occasionally rolling over. And you can see just how comfortable they are in our presence. Oh, fast asleep, kitty. Now the temperature should start dropping shortly, so hopefully they'll get a bit more playful. Hello, Nicole in Canada. Nicole would like to know what would happen if Karula gave birth while these cubs were still theoretically in her care. Before she did, she would probably have a concerted effort to chase them off. She'd become very aggressive towards them. Now, it is possible, outside possibility, since she was mating with Tingana, well, how old are they now? 10 months. So theoretically, if she did get pregnant during the last bout of mating, she would have a new set of cubs in 3 months, leaving these guys at sort of a year old. Now, it's very unusual then for leopards to become independent a year old. It's not impossible. The youngest I've heard of is 8 months, being independent from mom, and that's because mom died though. But it'll be very interesting to see. Now, there's so much speculation into why Karula started mating with Tingana, and I'm 100% sure it wasn't a false estrus. False estruses do not last for as long as she was mating with him, and she mated a full cycle with him. I think it's possible she is getting old, that her hormones might be starting to play up a little bit, so that could be a reason, but as I said, it's all speculation. And you must remember, leopards don't always get pregnant every time they mate, so there's probably a good chance she won't be pregnant from the last bout of mating, and she'll continue to look after these two cubs after the mating's finished. She's come back, she's already providing for them. And the other possibility, she might have thought she lost them, that she might have not been able to find them for a few days. But I still think that that time period that she started mating again was just too short in terms of them losing each other. We'd seen them together far too recently for that to be the case. I think it's just one of those things we must remember. As much as we know, there's so much we don't know. And that's the incredible thing about being out here. We get to learn every day. We get to see behavior that's interesting and sometimes unexplained, and gives us a good thing to chat around the fire about and ponder what's going on. Okay, well, we're going to sit here. As I said, we're playing the patience game with these leopards, and it has worked well for me in the past. So while we play the patience game, Taylor has managed to find the sunset. Well, hopefully she never lost it, but she's got a good view of it. And, of course, Bushwalk is starting to head home as it gets darker. So let's go see what they're up to.
I have to agree with Brent. The patient game definitely always pays off. So, Brent, I hope while you're sitting there and they're not doing too much, they decide to wake up soon and give you the most amazing show. Now, as you can see, we're back on this beautiful big open area with the sun behind us, a couple of clouds, and marulas that make the most perfect silhouette. And unfortunately, like Brent said, it's getting dark. It's time for us to start heading home. But I hope you've enjoyed this little stretch of the legs that we've given you today. And, well, maybe learnt a couple of things or two. But from myself, Viam, and of course, the wonderful Herbert, thank you for keeping us safe, Herbie. We've had a wonderful afternoon, and we'll see you back on the vehicles bright and early tomorrow for the Sunrise Safari. But don't worry. Worried that I'm saying goodbye. The show's not over. Evia and Brent are still out there. Let's go across to Evia. I'm not sure what he's got.
Welcome back. I was able to sort a couple of things out, and we are on lineup for those lions. There's a dung beetle pushing a dung ball in the road in front of us. There might be more than one there. I'm only seeing one, but I can't see how that guy. Yeah, there is one pushing and the other one's just on it, hitching a free ride. Maybe trying to steal it from the other one. I think we have found a pretty. If we zoom out a little bit, there's a pretty blue bird sitting just to the on the other side of this road, to the left. Where has it disappeared to now? Just off the road, blue waxbill. Tiny little bird, beautiful though. Pretty nice sunset as we're going into the last stretch of the light and last stretch of the day. I think let's just bypass these dung beetles and keep moving in the direction of the lions. We've had to make a big loop around. Cinema. Copy, perfect, thank you. We have just been invited into the lion sighting, so just hold on, I'm gonna put my foot down a tiny bit and try and get there quickly. Brian, how amazing is the setting with the sun and all that? There's, looks like a vulture in the tree in front of us. Two of them actually. Or is it just one? No, there's two heads sticking out. No, just one. Folks, while I keep moving towards the lions, we're gonna head over to Brent with the leopards.
Well, as you can see, all Hosanna has done is flop over. He's rolled over again. He's continuing his sort of slightly restless resting, and it's probably because he ate a bit more than his sister, so he can't quite get that belly as comfortable as he would like. So we are being very, very patient. And Sandra in California would like a folklore story about leopards. Oh, Sandra, now I'm just going to rack my brain for a folklore about leopards. I'm trying to think, there was one I know, but not that well, about the leopard and the hare. Oh, let me think about other leopard ones. Oof. I'm trying to remember now. Okay, well, I'll see if I can remember the leopard and the hare. I mean, well, since we've got leopards in shot, I'm just making sure they were there. So it goes back a long, long time ago. Hare used to work for leopard, basically, as a nanny. Used to look after her cubs. And there was a massive drought, and all the water in their area dried up, and a lot of the animals moved away towards where there was water. So there wasn't a lot of food around. And it took about a month or so of almost no food. And obviously, leopard would give her food to her cubs first, and hare would get at the end. And after a month and a half, leopard had to travel further and further and further to get her prey, and she was coming back unsuccessfully after unsuccessful hunt after unsuccessful hunt. And this time she had three cubs, so they were still quite small, so she was nursing. And eventually, the one day while the female leopard was out hunting, hare got so hungry it decided, you know what, I'll just eat one of leopard's babies. No, I mustn't, but I'm so hungry. Oh, I mustn't, but I'm so hungry. So eventually the hunger overcame hare, and hare ate one of leopard's babies. And when leopard got back and called for her babies to be brought for suckling, hare took one at a time. So one suckled, then he would take it away, and then he brought the second one. And then when that one was done, he brought the first one back again. So leopard still thought there were three. And eating that one baby sustained hare for a good 4 or 5 days. And in that time, leopard hadn't caught any food. And then hare was like, oh, I'm so hungry. No, I mustn't. Yes, I will. And ate another one of the baby. And hare did that again. So only one baby left. And it would take the baby that the one suckled and swap it out. So rotate the same baby through three times. Leopard then went off again hunting, but another week later, again no success. And by that stage, hare had already eaten all the babies. Dave, this is not a funny story. Why are you laughing at a rabbit eating a leopard baby? It's a folklore. Thank you, Dave. And so eventually, hare came up with this scheme, because obviously in most African cultures, hares and jackals are the tricksters. They're the nonsense makers. And he took the blood of the remaining cub it had just eaten and spread it all over it and made it look like there'd been a massive fight. And hare tried to blame the peaceful people of the village who came and took her cubs. And leopard broke into a fury of roars and snarls and rushed off towards the village. And the grey go-away bird said, wait, it wasn't the hare. I mean, it wasn't the good people of the village, it was the hare. And that's why to this day a scrub hare is always running, because it's running from the wrath of the leopard. There we go, there's a African folklore. I can't remember whether it was Zulu or Xhosa, but it's quite an old one now. So I must actually double check my folklore books. Maybe I should look it up, a few more leopard folklore. I used to know so many. I must be getting old. There we go, the sun is setting. Quite lovely. Here we go. You can see the sky darkening. Now, little leopards, this is when you're supposed to start playing. As it gets cooler, or at least go for a drink at the waterhole. A But as you can see, the young leopards are not maneuvering at all, being very lazy. Although young Shongile did manage to roll over while I was telling my story, you sneaky little minx, you. Now, as tempting as it looks to sort of go on young Hosanna's belly, if one was to do that, he would leave you with a serious amount of stitches. Even a little leopard of this size would do some serious damage to a human being. We're quite soft and not much fur to protect us from those razor sharp claws and teeth. Oh, there you saw that little nervous flick, keeping the insects off. AC is wondering whether Hosanna is developing a baby dewlap. No, he's not. A male leopard is only really going to start developing his dewlap at around 4 and older. Some leopards even older than that, 5. But I don't think he's going to be developing a baby dewlap. I mean, he's just got a baby fat belly from being a greedy guts at that impala kill. Because as you can see, young Shongile is much skinnier. Or, we never know, maybe young Hosanna was fishing for terrapins all day today next to this mud wallow. Did you eat all the terrapins, Hosanna? So, we're spoiled with big cats on Monday Madness, leopards and lions. So, we're going to keep waiting right here, not go anywhere. But let's go see what the Nkuhuma is up to.
Welcome back. We have joined the lion sighting. Still fast asleep. Doesn't look like there's much action. The one female's licking herself now. But hopefully soon we'll start getting a couple of yoga stretches and a bit of yawning, which will be a good indication of them wanting to move. So keep our fingers crossed and let's wait and see what's happening. Molten, you are asking if the cubs will be getting any hunting lessons soon. I think they are a little bit young to join in the hunts, in the physical hunts, but in a couple of months' time they'll be a lot closer and start getting tips from the adults. For the moment it's just play amongst each other, chasing each other around and stalking each other, stalking the adults, and that is how they'll develop for the moment. When this vehicle moves out, we will reposition and get a nice view of them and maybe a bit of the sunset as well. I'm just gonna make a little bit of space for them. Just move back a tiny bit so that they can get out of here. Think they should be able to get on. Look at that. Afternoon. Right. Let's get out their way. Lucy, you are asking if it's dirt on the cubs or if it is still mange. It is still a bit of mange. It looks like they're a lot healthier though, and Brian was also telling me they're looking a lot better. So slowly but surely getting back to good health. But unfortunately it is still a bit of mange that's on their bellies. AJ, you are asking if there's any natural remedies to fight the mange. I don't think so. I don't know of any. I haven't been told anything that the animals would use. So I think it's just as their condition gets better, they'll grow healthier. Look at that stretch. Oh, look at the claws coming out. Back in, nice yawn. Is that the cub that's called Floppy Ear? And Taylor told me it's her favorite cub. Interesting. There was a place that both Taylor and I worked at that had a female, an adult female. It was also called Floppy Ear. Or Mandlev. Mandlev is the Shangaan word for ear. Quite a fierce leader of that southern pride in the southern Sabi sands where we worked at. I had a very interesting encounter on foot with Mandlev. It was her and three other lionesses, or two other lionesses, in a big open area, and we were following a male lion's tracks from the Sabi River heading up north into the area of our former workplace. We then lost his tracks and we found these other tracks, which everyone at first thought were the male's tracks, and as we found out later, it wasn't. It was Mandlev and her two companions. So my tracker and I were walking on the road with a stick playing, marking the tracks, and the next minute we heard something run out of a little thicket in this open area. And at first I thought maybe a duiker or a steenbok that got a fright and ran off. And as I lifted my head, we had these three lionesses looking at us like 15, 20 meters away. And we grabbed each other and gave each other a big hug, stood together to try and look bigger. And the people on the vehicle a couple of meters away were like, "What are you doing? Why are you hugging each other?" And we said, "Lions." And we're pointing to the lions. And like, "What? What are you saying?" Said lions, and eventually they saw the lions, and slowly but surely we crept back to the vehicle. Luckily we didn't get any aggression out of this floppy-eared lioness, because she was known for giving the guys a bit of a fright when they're trekking on foot. She's definitely not a lioness that you want to walk into when you are tracking her and she's got cubs. So with her, and in a situation like this, I wouldn't have walked in and tried to look for her. Some flies bothering the one lioness just to the left of this one, grooming himself. I always wonder how these animals are so comfortable sleeping when they don't have any bedding or pillows to rest their heads on. I always find it looking quite awkward when they're lying down. It was amazing when... It is amazing when you're looking at a fine detail like this, and what the camera allows us to do is like zoom in onto those paws. You can see the amount of hair between the digits of their toes and around their foot, around the back pad of their foot. That allows them to move around very softly. Another thing that helps with that is them stepping exactly where the back foot going, exactly where the front foot was before, when they walk around.
Maybe if one of them gets up and starts moving, we'll be able to show that to you. Janice, you are asking how much longer these cubs will be nursing for. From what I can gather, these cubs are about 6 months old. I think they'll be starting to get taken off the milk slowly but surely. But they'll still drink for a couple of months at least. Get milk every now and then, just less and less of it as they keep going and growing. There's one still having a proper drink there. See how the one that's drinking and the one next to it, the one that was drinking or is still drinking, look how his ears are folded back, protecting the ears from maybe fighting. If often around kills, you see that as well when they're feeding, like pull the ears and tuck the ears into their head. It just adds, often around a kill, there'll be a slaps being handed out and a lot of biting and grunting at each other, and with the ears being folded in, that protects them quite well. Catherine, your comment saying that you love how the lions snuggle together, it is amazing. And it's also very important that they do snuggle up and have a bit of contact. It just keeps group cohesion and just, the relationships of the animals intact. Often when they've split up, moved off and get back together, you will see a lot of touching and caressing of each other, greeting each other, and that all helps and adds on to the group and the relationship, how strong the relationship and the bond is. Bless you. The female that's giving a bit of milk is sneezing now. Christina in Australia, you are asking if I think the lion's fur will grow back after the mange is gone. I think it will. I don't know, Brian, did they look a lot worse and slowly but surely coming back?
Yeah,
that's awesome. So definitely that'll, when their condition gets better, it'll grow back and they'll look like proper healthy lions again. Heat feels like it's lifting a bit. It's cooling down nicely now as the sun is disappearing. Nice bit of cloud cover. The hopes I had for rain that we had this morning, I don't think is going to come today. But it should at some stage come. We're hoping and keeping our fingers crossed that it'll come sooner than later. Hopefully this, the heat and the clouds and the humidity will just keep building over the week, and we'll get some good thunderstorms to fill up all the different dams in the area. I think one of the lions is snoring. Brian, did you hear that? It sounded like one of them was snoring. Maybe this female closest to us on the right. Or no, it's the cubs fighting for the milk. It sounded a bit like a snore. Michelle, you are 100% right. Lions are very patient mothers. I mean, you can just imagine those little sharp teeth biting into you to get to the milk. That would not be the nicest feeling, and they just lay there and take it. Only up to a point though, but they take it for the moment and for the time being. It is such a privilege to just be able to sit here and watch these animals do their thing without us being any sort of a pain to them. We're not bothering them at all. They just carry on with their daily routine as if we weren't here. It's such a privilege to be part of something like this. Get a bit of insight to the lion life.
That lioness is snoring.
She is snoring.
Yeah.
So I wasn't lying. Snoring and fighting for milk. Hello? Mum that was giving milk has just gotten up. Let's see if we can see when she starts walking. Look at the paws and where she places the back paw. Almost exactly where the front foot was before. Herself. Brian, I hope we're in the right spot for the wind, otherwise it's gonna smell horrible. Charlie, you are asking how many lionesses am I counting? I can see 4 at the moment, unless I'm missing one. But yeah, just 4 at the moment. One might be sleeping under a bush somewhere that we're just not seeing at the moment. But I think the entire group is here. I wonder if this little cub is going to come back and try and get some more milk. Let's see. For another helping. Mama, 1 second. Folks, while I spend a little bit more time with these amazing creatures, we're gonna head back over to Brent and see what those leopards are up to.
Well, not much, just some swatting of flies. Oh, Shungile's just lifted her head. Come on, madam, time to get moving, or at least start harassing your brother. We've been playing the patience game so nicely. Of course, one of those unfortunate things is not Not every time you play the patience game do you actually win at the patience game. Sometimes wildlife wins, but it is worth spending extended periods with these creatures. That is the best way to see some of the most incredible interactions that most people never get to see. Woof, Lynn. Lynn would like to know what has been my most favorite leopard encounter. Well, let's just have a look. Hello, little one. Oh, you are pretty. No, you're supposed to wake up and start harassing your brother now. Sorry about that, Lynn. She just turned over to face us. She is starting to look like she's a little bit more active than Hosanna. A few yawns, a bit of cleaning, and her eyes are not completely shut. But Lynn would like to know, what is my favorite leopard interaction? Well, Lynn, that's a good question. But I think I've had some incredible ones over my time in the bush. Oof, now I've got to think. I think I'll make it a bit easier. I'll stick to my best leopard interactions since I've been at Safari Live. Oh, there have been so many. I mean, one that comes to mind is with Kunyuma, Quarantine's brother. We don't see anymore. He's moved further south, and he's the first leopard I found on foot as well, here on Juma. And he had a bush buck kill, and he'd finished eating it and he sauntered off towards Chele Pan for a drink, and there was a buffalo bull lying in the water, and he smacked it on the bottom and then jumped up a jackalberry for no reason. And then the next morning we had him, same, another incredible encounter with him. I had him climbing up a really rickety old leadwood tree. He nearly fell off about 5 times and just really being a silly cat. And of course he had that amazing personality where he'd be sleeping just like these guys are, completely ignoring us, and then he would get up and snarl at you for no reason. So he was quite fun. And then of course another one of my favorites was definitely when Mvula beat up Sindile up in the tree right next to us. And how could I forget finding these two little monsters when they were about 6 hours old? It was a very special moment for me. And very seldom you find leopard cubs that young. You normally find them when they're a couple of days old, but we found them within hours of their birth. Let's try and think. I had some wonderful encounters with Hosanna, Shongile and Karula on foot. I think my favorite one was I was tracking. I'd found where they had Karula had killed a dike, and I was following the drag of where she took it down into the drainage line. It was really thick. I didn't want to walk straight to where it was. So I walked up on the bank on the other side, and I must have been about, I don't know, 6 feet from them looking down. And Hosanna looked at me and then hissed at me and then carried on eating. Karula sort of looked over her shoulder and then just went back to sleep. Now that was quite a special on-foot sighting. Oh, I'm trying to think, there's just so many. I'm so lucky to spend time with all these leopards. Also, young Sindile, tracking him when Shadow abandoned him for a while was awesome, because we'd find him in a similar area almost every day, and often you'd find him on a big termite mound. And as you walked back to the car to go take the vehicle in, he would actually follow you back to the car. And Quarantine's done that to me as well. And I wonder if these two will start behaving just like that. I hope so. And it's really, really special when you get to spend as much time with these incredible cats as we do. Even when they're snoozing. Hey, mister. There's a possibility Karula might not even be back and they'll be on their own for the night if she is unsuccessful in catching something. Oh, I thought he might go for a drink. No, not just yet. Come on, guys, it's cool now. You're supposed to jump up and down, run up trees, jump on each other. Now, Dan would like to know, if something were to happen, like a male lion running in here, I suppose, or hyena or something, Would they have each other's back or not? I'm afraid it's the or not. That solitary cat instinct takes over and it's each leopard for itself, especially with these two. Depending on the situation, mom might defend them to a point, but at the end of the day, quite often what happens is if it's a really serious situation, the females will abandon the cubs to their fate. And the theory is that they can always breed again and make more cubs. Now, you must remember that in this particular area, leopard cub mortality is very high. It's about 70% for the Sabi Sands. So, with only 3 in 10 cubs that are born survive to a year old. So Karula is absolutely a fantastic mother. She seems to get these more cubs through than any other female leopard I've encountered. Now, it's quite lovely, especially at this time of the night, sitting here, because there's a wonderful smell that's starting to waft as the air gets cooler. And I'm going to show you. There. Yes, there. You can see those beautiful white flowers. It's wild jasmine, and in the late evening, as it gets cooler, the smell, that's the leaf, Dave. It's shiny. No, that's also a leaf, Dave. There we go. There are the flowers. Well done, Dave. So, as it gets cooler, that smell of jasmine permeates the air, and it is quite a spectacular smell. And especially when you're out in the bush, often things are really smelly. Lions, dead buffalo, dead carcasses, even the mud wallows are quite smelly. So it's quite a nice change to have this incredibly beautiful aroma wafting out of the bushes. I wonder where Karula could be. Oh, hi, Bill. I'm assuming you didn't make this mistake, but it was final control. Why do leopard cubs look so much more cleaner than leopard cubs? I assume you assume why do leopard cubs look so much more clean than lion cubs? But that was Kirsten who said that. Not you, Bill. Don't worry. I know. I'm just mocking Kirsten when I get the opportunity. So they generally are quite a bit cleaner as well. They're quite fastidious groomers, and also they don't eat a lot of those really big smelly carcasses. So they don't sort of climb into the rib cage of their dinner, whereas a lion cub will be in there, right in there. So and also they take their time. They're not so much as wolfing down the carcass and fighting. And they put the kill in the tree. You will notice that it's very rare to ever see two leopards feeding at the same time because of that solitary behavior. And so even the female, she'll eat, then the male eat, then the female eat, and then they won't all eat at the same time. So you don't have that squabbling. And at the moment, the leopard cubs are looking very, very pretty, but some of the Nkumas have still got a bit of mange, so they could be helping them look not so lovely. And also, lion cubs tend to carry scars from a much earlier age. They get battered around by males and females at those frenzied carcass feedings. So, I'd say, life's a little bit tougher for a little lion. There's lots more things to whack you around the ear. Now, speaking about how scruffy little lions look, it seems like Efia is still with those incredible Nkuhumas, so let's go take a look.
Welcome back. It looks like this little cub is trying to cover up his eyes. I wonder if he's thinking, when are we going to start moving? And like almost like scratching his head about it, or if he's covering his eyes to get the last to avoid the light. Not that I think that's that, but it's a possibility.
The only movement we've had so far is just the lions chasing around flies, biting at them, chasing them with their tails and their paws. There's been no sign, no yawning yet, no sign of them wanting to get active anytime soon. But we've got the time. Let's sit and wait and see what they get up to. Something's got their attention. There's another lion that's calling, maybe that fifth lioness. It's contact calling just to the left of us. Lana, age 13, you're asking about which of the predators get the least amount of sleep. I think the poor cheetahs get the least amount of sleep. Look at that. In a flash, everyone is up and calling each other. Just listen to that. Let's just reposition here quickly. I think we are going to struggle to follow these lions if they go into the bush further further to the east. It looks like it's quite a thick bush with a couple of drainage systems in it. So let's have a look at them. I don't think we're gonna have them for much longer. Yeah, it must be that other female that was calling them. Listen to that little cub calling. We have gotten on the other side of the wind now, and where that lioness relieved herself, it's all blowing towards us and we're picking up the smell. It is not the nicest smell to be around. I wonder if there's a way for us to get on the other side of this drainage line. And then maybe try and make our way in and try and catch up with them again. Brian, do you think we should quickly race around and see if we can get them again? Or are we going to get stuck there? While we head around and try and find these lions again, we're going to head back to Brent with the leopard, and it sounds like there's something exciting happening there.
Now, Efe is spot on. Young Hosanna spotted some impala and he leopard crawled forward. Let's see if he carries on. Now, he's probably capable of taking a baby impala. An adult might be a bit too big for him. Oh, it looks like he might have lost interest now. Dave, can you see those impala? I've gone behind a bush for me. Can't see them. They're still quite far away. So, yeah, there's the little mud wallow. The impala were to the north of us, but we can't see them now. I don't want to move the vehicle just yet. Okay, Dev, go behind you. And, okay, stop, zoom. You see those two there? Okay, keep zooming into that quarry bush. Through there is an impala. There we go. You just see that movement a little bit to the right? Now you center frame a little bit back. There we go. You can see the movement there. I can't see if there are any babies or if it's an adult male or anything like that, but that's where the impala are. Wouldn't it be exciting if he managed to catch one? Looks like he's almost given up already though.
But see, this is where the patience game comes in, and being with the cats at the right time of the day. Shongile is still fast asleep. Oh, he's railing around a bit, hugging herself, and back to sleep. Okay, I can't see whether any babies. I can just make out that it's an impala through the thickets. I can see now there's definitely one female. Left a bit. Here we go. Ellen said I mentioned that Hassana had caught an adult duiker the other day. Where did I get that information from? I got that information from Arethusa. They saw him do it. And apparently it took him over an hour to kill the duiker. So he probably hasn't fine-tuned his hunting skills yet. Now, it's in these moments where mom leaves them behind where the fine tuning of those hunting skills happens. And it happens with squirrels, Franklin, dwarf mongoose. But then that confidence they build, because you don't need to teach a leopard how to hunt it. It's got all that instinct there. And the confidence they build, look, there we go. And the practice they get when mom's away is what turns them into effective adult predators. Look at that. Look at him go. He's still a long way off from that impala. Probably 60 meters. Now, he's got a lot of open ground to cover between him and those impala, so it's quite likely he's going to get spotted. But, as I said, practice makes perfect. On average, leopards have a success rate of around 10 to 15%, depending on the area. So, only sort of every 1.5 times out of 10 that they chase something do they catch it. He's given up. Also, an adult impala might just look a bit too big for him just yet. You can see he's gone back to a normal pose now. He's still watching the impala. The impala haven't seen him, obviously, otherwise they'd be snorting. But they are moving away from him. Ashley is wondering how far the Inkahumas are from where we're sitting with these leopards. They're quite far, actually. They're quite deep inside Arethusa. I'd probably say 5, maybe 5.5 kilometers. Oh, I can't see those impala again. They are moving away. And his interest seems to be less intent than it was. I think he might have been hoping they were going to come straight towards him and make it easy for him at the waterhole. Oh, Shongile is up. Hello, little Songololo. Is it time to play yet? Is it time to leap on Brother Deer? Make him work off some of that belly of his. And you can see from his body language, he's completely given up on those impala now. Now, hopefully, they'll be around here on tomorrow's sunrise safari. Hopefully, we arrive as Karula does to lead them off to a kill. It's always fun following the royal family through the bush. And the last extended sort of follow I did with them is when we got to see the joint killing of a poor little squirrel by both Hassana and Shongile. Hassana initiated, then let it escape, and Shongile finished the job. So we're going to leave these wonderful little leopards to spend their evening here. It is getting dark. Mom's not here, so we're going to leave them be, and hopefully we'll find them bright and early tomorrow morning on the sunrise safari. While we do that, Effia has managed to find the lions, so from Dangerous Dave and myself, adieu.
Folks, we have found these lions again. Just doing our last bit of maneuvering in here. Just bear with us. See if we can get a bit closer. They are back sleeping again. There'll be a lot of maneuvering around here. Ryan, just hold on. This is gonna be a bit bumpy. We made it over. They are just to the right of us here. There's two cubs drinking again. So I haven't done a head count again, but I would guess that all five of the females are here now. It must have been the other female that called them and brought them through the drainage line back to where they are now. Should we go forward a bit more? One, two, three, one. All five of them are here. We're looking at the one giving milk at the back, the two adult lionesses in the middle, and then the one giving milk in the front. And then just to our right, we've got the fifth lioness. It is great that they've all gotten together. Folks, we are close to the end of our show. I would like to thank Brian and the Thumb for a wonderful afternoon exploring Arethusa. Thank you to all the other guides and their vehicle on the vehicles and on foot. Ladies in FC, thank you for all your help. And most of all, and most important, all the viewers, it was brilliant having you. We're going to have a look at these lions for the last bit of the drive. We'll see you tomorrow morning on the Sunrise Safari.